Many authors approach me with questions such as, how do I know if my research paper is ready to be submitted to a journal? Or maybe, what improvements can I make to my research paper to increase my acceptance in journals? Well, what savvy researchers do is they seek advice from people and professionals at academic conferences. Hi, and welcome back to another Uni-edit video. My name is Anthony, and today Jenny and I are going to talk about why you should get feedback at a conference before publishing your paper. To start, Jenny, could you remind us why we should be attending an academic conference?
Of course. One of the main reasons to attend a conference is to present your research and share your ideas with experts in your field so that you can invite questions and comments that will ultimately help you to strengthen your work before having it published.
Awesome. So after you present your research, who should you get feedback from?
Well, by networking at a conference, it's possible to obtain feedback from not only people in your own field, but also people in related fields and experienced researchers from other institutions. You can make contact with these people in various ways.
One way to meet other researchers is through chance conversations. A chance conversation is simply a casual conversation you strike up with somebody in many different scenarios at a conference. They're generally unplanned, and they can happen anywhere, maybe in line at a coffee shop, maybe when you're sitting down waiting for a presentation to happen. And in fact, attendees who follow up with researchers who presented on information that caught their attention normally get the most value out of conferences. You can do this by approaching the speaker in the hall or by using a conferencing app. These are good because you might be able to schedule a casual coffee meeting with them later in the conference. You can meet and talk to the presenters you love by approaching them casually in a hall or by messaging them on a conferencing app. Having coffee with them is a great and casual way to discuss their research more, but also to discuss yours.
Another way to strike up conversations is by taking advantage of those fleeting moments between main events. So, for example, if you have time when sitting in a session before the presenter speaks, you could chat to the person sitting next to you. Or if you're waiting in a lineup for food or coffee, you could ask the person behind how their day is going instead of passing the time looking at your phone. However, it can be nerve-wracking trying to strike up conversations. So it is a good idea to think of some conversation starters to use in a variety of different contexts before you leave for the event, or even during your travel time. Don't worry about sounding scripted. In fact, brainstorming a list of questions to ask can make them sound more natural when you're nervous. And it helps you to avoid drawing a blank when you approach someone. So some simple questions you could start with include things like, where are you from? Or what brings you to this conference? Or what sessions or speakers are you looking forward to the most? Or which sessions or speakers did you enjoy, if you're asking afterwards?
Sorry for the interruption. This is a friendly reminder to click like below to support this kind of free content in the future. You can also click subscribe to keep up to date with all of our new videos. And now we're going to talk about your elevator pitch. An elevator pitch is a well-planned, short introduction to you and your research. Before you go to a conference, you need to think about the information that is most important about you and your research that people at the conference will also find most interesting. If you really want to network at a conference, you need to prepare a quick summary of your field research and the reason you are attending the conference, such as what you want to learn or what you're most excited about. But this can get a little complicated if there are researchers, professionals, and exhibitors at the conference. You might need 3 or 4 varied pitches depending on who you're talking to. Regardless of the situation, you should be able to give this speech in 30 seconds or less in a casual setting, such as waiting in line to get coffee. Now we're going to go back to Jenny, who's going to help us make first contact.
Right, thank you, Anthony. Yes, it's a good idea to reach out ahead of time through the conference mobile app to connect with key contacts you'd like to meet. Alternatively, you could follow them on LinkedIn or Twitter and introduce yourself, saying that you're looking forward to meeting them at the conference. Doing this increases the chances of them striking up a conversation with you in person, and it makes a positive first impression that shows your genuine interest in them. Later, when you do meet up with people, you should ideally focus on listening more than talking. It's a good idea to frame the discussion around what the other person is interested in and think about what you can do to offer that person. Avoid the temptation to convince people that you're an interesting and valuable contact during the first meetups, because this often leads to you doing most of the talking, and that doesn't give a great impression. It also reduces the information that you can gain for developing these relationships in the future.
If you're having a hard time talking to other people, or you're maybe alone at a conference, it's a really good idea to visit the exhibitor booths to get in the zone. People at these booths are generally really friendly, and striking up conversations with them can help loosen up your conversation chops. And as an added bonus, you're likely to learn a lot of good information and maybe snatch up some free chocolates or pens on the way.
One of the handiest ways to introduce yourself is to use the conference badges, because these show all the key information that you need to put your conversation into context, such as the person's name, their job title, and their organization. Use this tool to your advantage at every conference, even if it's just to help you remember people's names. Anthony, what do you think about people using business cards?
That's a really great question. Most people still use business cards to share their contact information. So it's a really great idea to have them, and you should put a lot of thought into the information and look of your cards. However, do not rely on them. You should really strive to have good and meaningful interactions and conversations with people before throwing your cards at them. If they have a good impression of you before they get your card, they're more likely to remember you. Another good idea is to put your picture on the card or a personalized message. People at conferences will be receiving dozens, maybe hundreds, of cards if they've networked appropriately, and many people might be easily forgotten. Don't be one of those people. Business cards are also useful if someone doesn't have time to have an in-depth conversation with you. You can exchange business cards and make a plan to get in contact in the future.
You'll also receive a lot of cards and learn mountains of information about the people who gave you those cards. So it's a good idea to keep some notes. You can do this by using a business card app to electronically store or manage your growing collection. Or you could write a few notes on each business card about the interactions you had with that person and the next action you should take to develop the relationship. For example, did you promise to send them something or call them? Did you add them on LinkedIn? Did they tell you their preferred method of contact? You might also want to make a note of something to remember them by, such as something they were wearing or something distinctive about the way they looked. Make these follow-up notes as soon as possible. It's much easier to think of what to write while your memory is fresh than try and recall that information a week later when it's all mixed together and faded from recall.
All right, we've covered a lot of great information so far, and now we're going to move in how to receive feedback. Unfortunately, a lot of people at conferences approach this with a get mentality and not a give mentality. If you're constantly searching for what people have to offer you and only looking for feedback on your work without thinking about what you can offer them, they may perceive your interaction as less genuine. If you approach an event with the desire to help others, they will see that and they will be more inclined to help you in return.
Networking doesn't end when the event ends. Some of the most important conversations and opportunities occur long after the doors of the venue close. So, don't leave it too long to follow up with each person you met at the conference. A simple thank you and an inquiry into how the event went for them is enough to keep your name fresh in their mind. If you have the time and want to go a step further, you could send an article that you think will be of interest to them. Later on, when the time comes that you need something from them, they'll be much more likely to respond. In addition, All attendees of a conference usually receive a set of hard copy or digital proceedings as an official record of a conference. These usually contain an abstract, but sometimes the full paper, of every presentation given at the event. These records make an invaluable collection of the latest research in your field. So once you get home from the conference, you can use these records to explore further research ideas and identify researchers in your field or in related fields that would be worth getting in touch with to discuss your work, particularly those that you didn't get the chance to meet in person. You can then use the proceedings as a point of conversation through which to introduce yourself via LinkedIn or some other platform. I hope this has been helpful to you. I will hand back over to Anthony for our final point. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jenny. So finally, we're going to talk about how to receive feedback from somebody whom you've never met. And this person might not have seen you at the conference or seen your presentation. You can do this by uploading your research to a so-called preprint archive, such as this. Colleagues and people in your field can comment on your research, which is a really cool resource. However, this is best for articles that are already under review and have been more or less accepted. Maybe your paper will have some small technical revisions, but it's certain that it will be published in the foreseeable future. In this video, we talked about a general plan that you should be making when attending an academic conference. I want to highlight again that you should be thinking well in advance about what you're going to be doing at the conference, who you hope to meet, and what to do in your free time. Making plans like this will increase your preparedness and will also make you look more professional. Using tools like conference badges and business cards are also great strategies. We also suggest that you write down things like elevator pitches and questions to other researchers, so when those conversations arise, you're prepared. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch this video, and a special thanks again to Jenny. We hope that this content has been useful to you. If it has, please click like below and subscribe to our channel. We look forward to seeing you in our next conference presentation video. Take care.